Get full access to over 20,000 episodes with your free trial. My Outdoor TV. Sign up today.
It's summer in the home of the European roe deer. Meadows, hedgerows, and woodland abound with lush greenery. And in the fields, the luxuriant grains are ready to be harvested. This is also the time of year where the roebuck's production of sexual hormones peaks, and the buck's attraction to the females is nearing a climax. Roe deer thrive on summer days like these. The bucks and the does, as well as the young ones, fully enjoy the gifts of nature. This time of year, adult animals consume as much as 1 kilo of dry plant matter every 24 hours, and the red summer coats are shining with well-being. The roebuck's antlers have already been stripped of their velvety skin and are now dark-colored with ivory tips from the buck's territorial marking on young trees. Magnificent to look at, the red summer bucks almost appear conscious of their own beauty. This is also the time of year where the roebuck stalker gets ready for action. For months, he's been studying the mature bucks on his beat in order to select the ones to be culled. We're in Dorset, in southern England, an area renowned for magnificent roe deer trophies. From majestic metal heads of symmetrical beauty to highly sought-after abnormal heads. At this time of year, the roebucks are extremely active in their territorial marking. A sense of restlessness is slowly spreading among the animals. It's time for the annual rut. When the territorial borderlines have not been clearly defined, a young, upcoming buck may want to try his luck. Then the master buck must immediately get into action to push out the intruder. This morning, the professional stalker Paul Taylor has invited his client, Eric Peterson, to join him in an attempt to lure a cunning old territorial buck by getting him to react to the call created by a so-called Botolo ball. This time, only a young buck showed. It's not uncommon that young and inexperienced bucks respond to the imitated call of a doe in heat. Uncertain, the young buck is nervously testing the wind before seeking safe cover. His barking calls prompt other animals to join in warning against the unknown source of the false mating call. Paul and Eric continue their careful stalk through the lush green forest. The dense vegetation makes it difficult to spot the animals, but Paul knows that an old buck resides in this area. During the past several years, Paul has only caught a glimpse now and again of this cunning and elusive buck when the rut has peaked. The two stalkers check the terrain carefully. They think they detected some movements in the undergrowth, but it's difficult to see through the dense cover of bracken.
Yeah, the sun streams down between the trees.
Paul tries to lure the buck out by carefully squeezing the Botolo. Eric is ready for immediate action. After a few minutes, they spot the buck between the trees, but it doesn't appear to want to move closer, possibly because it's in the company of a doe.
Steady on the others. It's a seven-pointer. There's a doe.
Paul continues to call in an attempt to lure the buck, but it remains reluctant to move. Eric prepares for a shot, but it's difficult to find an open line between the dense growths of trees. Paul's continued calling eventually prompts the buck to investigate, and it steps forward, more so than this camera angle suggests. As the shot rings out, the buck's head leaps forward and falls to the ground, while the doe runs for cover.
That is a good old buck, that is, yeah.
I could not always...
It was so difficult between the trees.
Your little boy. Oh, thank you, Paul. Very
well done, Eric. Well done.
I think the luck is with us today.
It is, isn't it? And it's so difficult in these trees when the buck's always moving, isn't it?
A well-placed bullet from Eric's caliber 243 causes the buck to expire after a short sprint.
Completely. Yep, yep.
That's an old man.
That is a very, very old man. Yeah.
An old man. Yeah. Oh.
It's got almost got three antlers, actually, hasn't it?
Yeah, there's a hair between.
Between them, that's right. Look at that.
Fantastic.
Wow.
It could be a heavy guy.
It could be. But look, you see? There's a problem with the eyes completely...
Yeah, destroyed.
Open, yeah, yeah.
How old is that buck?
That's probably, it could be 9-10 years old. Yeah, it's a very old one. You see the coronets are...
Very hanging, very
big. Yeah, yeah. And obviously this was caused by damage. You know, it's had a fight with another buck and the extra antler's grown where it's had damage pushed in there.
Oh, therefore they had this extra...
Yeah, and with the poor buck, his eye, it obviously spiked there by something. And
here we have a medal now.
I think so. I think that is a medal. Yeah, it should weigh heavy and has good volume. And yeah, definitely. But an old man, past his prime, and just the sort of thing to look for. An old trophy buck.
Thank you very much, Paul. Thank you very much. I really appreciate that. I do.
He's a very shy old buck, and I think it's at this time in the rut, you know, that it's the only time we're likely to see him. And
fantastic buck.
The stalkers are ecstatic. The buck is a bronze medal head. A wonderful conclusion of an excellent morning stalk. A large buck that has dominated this area for a very long time has been shot in a very sporting manner. The professional stalker, Paul, has many years' experience in the behavior of rutting roe deer, and he has learned the art of imitating the calls almost to perfection. Let's hear what he says.
You can make just a single tone, which is a doe, and imitated what I would think would be a doe noise, which was like this. That sort of spacing, or you could imitate a kid, or a kid in distress, perhaps, which would bring the mother, which is more of a scream, which is quite loud too. Yeah. So,
we heard it the other day.
Yeah, we did, that's right, when a kid was being chased by a buck, yeah.
And if you try this, how often I try it, half an hour or 2 minutes or what I do?
People's ideas vary on that, but personally, about every 15 minutes, if you arrive at a suitable place where you wish to start calling, I would put in a series of calls of different pitches immediately, using the buttalo and maybe using one of the other calls that you blow, and then leave it quiet for 15 minutes and just carefully listen and look around. If nothing happens, try again. But most important of all, really, is to, if you wish to pack up and go home or move position, then you must wait, and wait a long time, possibly half an hour, and then you know nothing has approached you, because a buck will sometimes approach very, very slowly and cautiously. They don't always come running to the call. They'll come very quietly and looking very curiously. So if you're not careful and you become impatient or move quickly away, then you might spoil a chance that you, otherwise you didn't know it had appeared.
When do you expect to start this calling in the rut? Is it the last end of July or and then the next 2 or 3 weeks or what?
Well, yeah, you get response probably from about the middle of July, maybe the 20th of July onwards, until probably you can get response to the call up until about 20th of August sometimes, but the core period when most response normally will be the first week of August, depending on weather conditions and where you're situated. And it varies from area to area within counties sometimes. So, you know, if you're out a lot stalking every day, then you see a pattern or you see a build up of movement.
Some days some mornings we have been out. You have an enormous success just a little on the call.
That's
the
right. Yes. Yeah.
And they immediately come running just up to us.
Yeah.
We've seen in some of the mornings and. And sometimes, if you have a good situation, the roebuck is not so interesting.
Yeah, it's strange, isn't it?
Depends on which stage she is on.
Absolutely right. And what you know, if he's with a doe, if the doe is very much in season, you know, and if he has other interests, maybe he's been fighting other bucks and defending his territory. Yeah. Then sometimes. No call, but just a rustle in the hedge will make him come. You know, even if it's an accident, maybe you've made a noise and rustled a twig.
Yeah.
Sometimes a buck will come to you because they're quite aggressive at this time of year.
Where's the wine?
The wine's on the side. Do you want to open the wine, or are you going?
The guest stalkers are lodged at Paul and his wife Bryony's place. Bryony has prepared an excellent meal, accompanied by a glass of wine. The fare of the day here is game meat, sika or Chinese water deer.
Well, Philip, this is it's a mixture actually. It's sika. The big pieces are sika.
Oh.
The little pieces are Chinese water deer.
Oh. Mm.
So, but all should be fillet. So hopefully all is well.
Chinese water deer from one of the animals.
Yes.
Wish you'd
yes.
Probably, yeah,
yes.
Probably, yeah.
Okay.
Could be yours. Could be Dan's.
I think it's mine.
Oh, yeah. Okay. You tell when you taste it. Yeah.
You'll know when you eat it.
Yeah.
Yours was the young one.
Lodging in the private home of Paul and Bryony is really comfortable, and the guests enjoy every minute of it. During the rut, it isn't uncommon with a midday stalk, as the mature bucks often move around at this time of day. But today, both stalkers and roe deer need a rest. Eric takes the opportunity to clean and check his old and trusted Steyr Mannlicher caliber 243 rifle. Eric prefers a normal cartridge for roe deer. The rifle is equipped with a 12x56 Zeiss scope. Confidence in one's rifle is important at all times in order to produce consistent and precise bullet placement. Eric knows this better than anyone. Eric and Paul share their passion for roebuck stalking. They have both seen a very good buck in this area without getting into shooting range of it. The stalkers are approaching the area where the buck has been seen most often when Paul spots a couple of deer at the foot of a small hill.
There's a doe and a buck here.
Okay.
I'll put the sticks up. Have a look.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
Eric studies the buck in his 20x60 Zeiss binoculars, and Paul wants to make sure that is indeed the buck that they are after.
The hill. I think it's an abnormal buck that I've seen before here. The doe's feeding.
Okay.
Yeah. Will you get ready? I'll squeak.
Okay. Right.
Yeah.
Stand just this side of me.
Okay. Yeah.
Eric prepares for a shot while Paul is calling the buck.
Okay. Yeah.
buck makes long necks while trying to detect where the calling sound is coming from. It advances slowly.
Run into the woods, so I'm just listening for a noise. It looked like a good strike, but he was...
The camera angle appears to put the doe in the line of the shot, but the stalkers had made sure that a passing shot was possible. Another successful stalk has produced yet another fine culled buck.
What's wrong with that?
How can it run with that shot?
Well, it's incredible, isn't it?
Thank you again, my friend.
Well done.
I'm very happy for that, Paul.
What a strange, unique trophy.
That's a bonus,
isn't it?
For, yeah. As you said, a bonus because you have seen it in a far, far away.
Yeah.
Just on the one side.
Absolutely amazing.
Here.
No, I think this buck used to live on the downs up here, further along. And then he relocated to his territory before.
What is happening here?
Well, it doesn't seem to have ever grown an antler at all there, does it? No.
It's a little
tiny bit. You can feel... It's weird, isn't it?
It's a little strong animal.
Very, very.
A little bull.
You'll find it's very old.
Do you think he's very old?
Yeah, I think he is, yeah.
Already the next morning, Eric and Paul are at it again. The sun slowly burns some patches of morning mist away and reveals the beautiful rolling Dorset landscape. The two stalkers have found an excellent vantage point at the top of a hill. With their powerful binoculars, they search every inch of the land below. Paul knows that there are several strong bucks in this area, one in particular that he has known for years, which he thinks is now ready to be culled. From their vantage point, the stalkers have now spotted the buck. He's eagerly waiting on a doe. The animals are quite far away, but with his powerful binoculars, Paul is able to make sure that it is indeed the buck they're looking for. The buck is easily recognizable with its tall, very symmetrical set of antlers. The stalkers have quickly changed position. They must be very careful now because even though the buck is preoccupied with the doe, Paul knows that it has an acute sense of imminent danger. 30 minutes have passed already, so perhaps the animals have moved to a different place. It's important to be fully alert, one step at a time. The buck is totally consumed with the doe, so how the situation is going to develop depends entirely on where she wants to go. The doe must be very near climax, the way she stops to allow the buck almost to mount her, before taking a step forward at the last moment. The stalkers need to pass through several hedgerows in order to get to where they spotted the animals. It's important to move forward very slowly. The buck and the doe are still in the field, but now at the far end of it. The animals don't appear to want to move closer. They keep moving back and forth in the same track. Paul decides to chance a difficult stalk out in the open.
That's the one we're looking for, yes.
The buck is totally preoccupied with the doe and senses nothing else, lost to the world.
Free me alone.
Yeah. I think we should go a little bit further up. The sun is on our back now, so we can go in the shadow of the hedge a little bit further up.
Yeah. Now they leave me. We're just walking slowly.
We just walk slowly, yeah.
Slowly and very carefully, the stalkers move forward. This is as far as they're able to get. Paul is worried about how little of the buck's body they are able to see. If he uses the Botello, perhaps he can get the buck to move closer.
Difficult to see the buck's body, but if he gets up and moves, then there may be a chance.
Could you make a sound with
the buttock? I could try that, sure. If you get ready anyway. Yeah.
The buck is still busy while Eric prepares for a shot. If only they can get it to stand still in a shootable position for a moment. Paul squeezes the Botello a couple of times and makes the buck lift its head.
Yeah, he's jumping.
Now it's in a good position. No, it's turning its head.
It's not really good, Paul. He has the back to me.
Yeah, yeah. It's turned his head round. It's licking his body.
Now, steady the nerves.
Now I think it's ready.
Okay. Okay, looked like a good hit. Yeah, it is. It's fine. Absolutely fine.
In slow motion, you're actually able to see the bullet as it hits the buck.
When I want to hit the bullet.
Yeah, it looks like a good position for the shot. So. Yeah, excellent.
Paul, we did it again. Thank you, my friend.
You're welcome.
I'm 100% sure, Paul, that it is more than a Bronx.
Yeah, I know.
I think it's more.
I normally underestimate, as you know, think it's more
but
than a Bronx.
But I can see when it was in the sun was coming up and there was this dark angler.
Yeah, that's right, dark angler.
We did it again, Paul.
Yeah, it is. It's a very good calibre. Yeah.
Where is that robot?
Somewhere here, isn't it? Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
A long and exciting stalk has been successfully concluded. The buck is precisely as old as the stalkers had estimated it to be, with a beautiful, tall, and symmetrical set of antlers.
What a nice trophy, Paul.
Wonderful. You see here?
Yeah.
Here's a cataract.
Yeah. Yeah. Something wrong with
that? Yeah, I saw that a couple of weeks ago when I was watching him. Yeah.
Very, very, very nice.
Mm.
Very, very nice.
And this is also very distinctive, the downward turning.
Close to a perfect roebuck.
Mm.
White and high and brown. And
And a little bit of damage here. Look where he's
snapped off the brow.
Yeah.
Oh, good, Paul. Thank you for that.
Excellent.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Absolutely. It was a beautiful, just to have that situation again.
Yeah.
Close to the animal, and then shoot them.
Super.
Yeah. And Paul, would you say that is a typical buck from this area, or is there normally more heavy and smaller? What can we say?
What can we say here? Well, we get several types down here, really. We sometimes get them with very big coronets and a much thicker base to the antler. This is quite high for here, yes it is.
Yeah.
Typically when they get to a good age, the coronets start to slope here, and sometimes they are very large, sometimes they're like this one, not so big. But this one was distinctive because of its height, and also the V formation of the antlers too.
And if you said you were known for three seasons, what would you think the age would be of such a robot?
Well, I should look at him and think at the moment, without looking at the teeth, just looking at the body, the coronets, his general physique,
probably about 6-7 years, probably.
6 or 7 years?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And one good, when you go out and then look at the roe buck, mm-hmm. on the distance, what are you looking at so we can see, what are you, the best sign of an age?
A good sign of age, yeah. Well, obviously the thick neck is a good sign of a strong animal and an older animal.
Must look like a little bull.
It must, that's right, a bull yeah. neck, that's yeah. right. And also I use my long telescope to look at the coronet of the buck. And also sometimes with the face, the nose is very short here. And the face is sometimes grey, although the grey colour is there with some bucks at an earlier time. But sometimes the back is hollow at the top, and
okay.
the belly maybe sag a little bit.
Mm.
And also the rump, the backside, yeah. needs to be square and flat when you look at it from the backside.
Apart from one small flaw, a broken front point, it's an unusually handsome trophy head. A typical Dorset buck, and a silver medal for sure.
We hope you've enjoyed this free episode. To continue watching, start your free trial now.